Some days I wish I could go back. Not to change things, but to feel a few things twice. If you can't tell by everything, I'm a pretty big Disney fan. That's why a lot of people who know me got very surprised when I'd say I hadn't seen most of the live-action remakes that Disney has become so fond of. I finally got around to watching them all, and I have some thoughts. But rather than explain my thoughts in person for the 73rd time, I decided to do some exploration into exactly why these movies are so bad. In video form! Let's do this! First, let's break down a bit of Disney history. After Walt Disney's death in 1966 and his brother Roy's death in 1971, Walt Disney Productions floundered. Without their visionary founders, the films produced during this Disney dark age were widely considered to be flops. Although several would still have long-lasting legacies, they simply did not perform very well upon release. Then came the mid-1980s, and with it CEO Michael Eisner and studio chairman Jeffrey Katzenberg. In 1986, Disney released The Great Mouse Detective. It did good enough. Although it was outperformed by Don Bluth's An American Tale the same year, The Great Mouse Detective did well enough to give the new executive team confidence to move forward with other projects. The period of the Disney Renaissance truly kicked off with The Little Mermaid in 1989. This was by far considered the modern heyday for Disney, with smash hits such as Aladdin, The Lion King, and Beauty and the Beast. Beauty and the Beast, released in 1991, became the first animated film to be nominated for an Academy Award for Best Picture. The films during this period made loads of money for Disney, fully bringing the studios into being a household name and a reliable box office success, even if some of the films from the Renaissance had problematic cultural elements. It's widely agreed that the Disney Renaissance ended in 1999 with Tarzan, after several relatively unsuccessful films, including Hercules and The Hunchback of Notre Dame. Some attribute this decline to Jeffrey Katzenberg leaving the studios in 1994 after a falling out with Eisner. From 1999 to about 2007 came Disney's experimental era, also called Disney's Second Dark Age. The films produced in this era were a mixed bag, to say the least. Which brings us to now. The present Disney revival era officially started right after Bolt in 2008. One of the traits of the revival era is a push away from traditional hand-drawn animation style and more towards CGI Pixar-style films, most likely due to Disney buying Pixar in 2006. This era also saw the return of princess stories, such as Tangled and Frozen. A subset of the revival era is what I like to call the remake period. Although Disney had actually done a few live-action remakes in the past, most notably the 1996 version of 101 Dalmatians, the remake period really kicked off in 2014 with Maleficent. From there, remake releases averaged once a year until 2019 when... So now that we're caught up, here's why I hate the remakes. I actually saw Maleficent almost immediately in theaters after seeing early positive reviews. And I really like it. It was a never-before-seen reimagining of a classic tale centered around what I consider to be one of Disney's top villains. Films such as Maleficent or Tim Burton's version of Alice in Wonderland focused on the characters from their original films, but not the plots. Alice is now returning to Wonderland for the second time, implying that the animated cartoon was still true. It was a reimagining of the world, and this time included some of Lewis Carroll's other tales, such as The Jabberwocky and Bandersnatch.
The Jabberwock with eyes aflame, jaws that bite and claws that catch. Beware the Jabberwock, my son, and the frumious Bandersnatch.
Maleficent may have followed the same basic story as Sleeping Beauty, but completely changed the circumstances of most of the characters. Maleficent always knew where Aurora was, and she proved instrumental in breaking the curse that she herself had set. Some of the other remakes attempted to recreate the idea of Maleficent and Alice in Wonderland. Dumbo had a plot completely divorced from the 1941 version, which was a really good idea given the, problematic elements in the animated version. Unfortunately, the Dumbo remake was a mess for a multitude of other reasons, but they fixed that overt racism, and that's what mattered, right? No need to make a coherent film where the characters had, I don't know, personalities? I honestly don't know if the Dumbo remake was meant to be earnest or satirical. It is one of the few live-action Disney movies to go full-out crazed cartoon villain. Some would think pairing Tim Burton with Dumbo was going to be genius. After all, Dumbo in 1941 gave this nightmare-inducing sequence.
Chase him away! Chase him away! I'm afraid! Need your aid! Big elephants on parade!
However, Burton's brand of bizarre did not mesh well with Dumbo, causing a confused film with no real direction.
Big elephants. So?
As time went on and more remakes were released, I became more disappointed. The reason I had so much hope for these remakes was because it seemed that they would all be complete reimaginings of the worlds and characters. The films started to become less creative and more like carbon copies of the original films they were pulled from. In essence, you cannot separate the remakes from the source material. It's hard for me to enjoy the new Lion King when I'm being reminded shot for shot of the 94 version. You're probably thinking, but Des, a lot of Disney films are taken from other stories or ideas. Aren't you being hypocritical? It is true that a lot of films, especially Disney films, are not wholly original ideas. But the difference lies in not just the number of changes made during adaptation, but why those changes were made. There's a huge difference between a folktale inspiring a film and a story being copied to the point of plagiarism. Because let's be honest, these remakes definitely qualify as plagiarism. The only reason they're not being called out on that is because Disney is plagiarizing itself, which is kind of funny considering how strict the Disney copyright lawyers can be. The Disney Renaissance films were not above criticism by any means. If you were a pedantic 12-year-old like me, your complaints mainly centered around things like, Hades wasn't actually trying to kill Hercules in the folklore, Hera was. Or, why would Cinderella's shoe be a perfect fit if it fell off at the ball? That last one still bugs me sometimes. Plot holes, inconsistent magical elements, or references that we won't understand until well into our teen years are constant fodder for internet message boards. Most of the Disney remakes appear to be directly responding to these criticisms. Some of the changes worked. Some did not. Remaking these movies allowed Disney to erase certain problematic elements that burned them from the original versions. The Lion King had this.
What do you want me to do? Dress and drag and do the hula? Wow! If you're hungry for a hunk of fat and juicy meat, eat my buddy Pumba here because he has a dream.
Which was exchanged in the remake for this.
It is with deepest pride and greatest pleasure that we proudly present your dinner.
Be Which was a very good move. That joke didn't age well, so let's change it. Another example of responding to criticism is that Scar in the 90s version is very queer-coded. For those that don't know, queer coding is when characters are given traits or behaviors to suggest that they are not heterosexual or cisgender, without the character being outright confirmed to have an LGBTQ+ identity. Disney has been judged in the media for years for their villains commonly being either queer-coded or clearly ripped from an individual in the LGBTQ+ community. Ursula from The Little Mermaid was famously based on Divine, a well-known drag queen from the 70s and 80s. Hades has also been called Meg's gay best friend. To combat this criticism, the 2019 version of The Lion King chose to rewrite the characterization of Scar, even though his lines would stay virtually identical. This was a lateral move to me. Choosing to rewrite Scar to avoid that familiar backlash was a relatively good idea. The downside is that Scar became really boring. Scar's sassiness and melodrama were the main aspects of his personality. His motivations were portrayed not only in his words, but in the way he said those words. His disdain for his brother was portrayed better in his tone and his facial expressions than in his actual words. The removal of the song Be Prepared was the biggest detriment to Scar's character in the remake. The entire song is just about Scar's motivations. It literally outlines his plans to use the hyenas for his own gain. Not only is this song vital to Scar's characterization, it's important for the hyenas too. It shows how the hyenas are moved by Scar's vision of a coup, a strategy that had never occurred to them before. Removing this song makes the audience unable to properly see the villain's motivations. So by changing the characterization, but not the spoken lines, you end up with a boring character. His actions are the same, but his motivations aren't displayed in an interesting way. You find yourself not really caring about what Scar is planning, because his only qualities now are in how he's related to the other lions. There's no longer a focus on what drives him as a character. It took something away, but supplied nothing to replace it. Also, where is the Scar? I can barely see it in this animation. Shere Khan has a more pronounced scar in The Jungle Book, which came out 3 years before The Lion King, so we know that they can animate a scar. I know, this is one of those pedantic little criticisms, but it still bothers me. Taking away things that worked in the original, but failing to replace them, is a bit of a trend in the remakes. Aladdin removes some of the early exposition that introduces us to several of the main characters. The things that they use instead are really not great. In the 1992 version, we meet Jasmine here, and we see her interact with her father before she ever meets Aladdin. This gives us insight into not only her personality, but her relationship with her father, the Sultan. This is also how the Sultan is introduced. In the remake, we don't see them interact until here, almost 20 minutes in, and after Jasmine has met Aladdin. Now, I do genuinely enjoy the bump in feminism we see from Jasmine. She has her own song, and her reasons for refusing the foreign suitors are based on a desire to rule herself instead of just, "I don't want to marry them." That's all a really great turn for Disney. But the independent feminist Jasmine is undercut by how she's introduced. There is one opening shot, but that is all we see of her until she meets Aladdin. You don't even hear her name until 19 minutes into the movie. By not letting her have her own opening scene, she isn't seen as her own person. First impressions in films are important. By tying our first meeting of Jasmine to her meeting Aladdin, our impression of her will always be tied to his. This damages the appearance of her agency. Her purpose in the film is to be attached to Aladdin, and her existence as her own person is an afterthought. Jafar is also done dirty in the remake. He's initially introduced in the film the same way, sending some poor sucker into the Cave of Wonders. But instead of showing his connection to the Sultan, the remake has to exposit it at us.
I do not understand what could possibly be in that cave that could help a man as great as you. You are already second only to the Sultan.
Second? Who's in trouble now?
And you think second is enough? Of course. You were not born to be Sultan.
They could have easily written this out and shown Jafar's place in the hierarchy through film language or by having him interact with the Sultan directly. Doing it the way they do makes the screenwriting feel amateurish. This line was only put in here to tell us, the audience, who Jafar is. It's stilted and unnatural. Also, who designed this giant Iago? It's horrifying and now haunts my dreams. Thanks, I hate it. Some of the changes in the remakes weren't boring per se, they were just completely unnecessary. Beauty and the Beast did a lot of this. This critically acclaimed film from 1991 has endured a lot of nitpicking from fans. And while the remake didn't address all the plot holes, it definitely tried to cover as many as possible. A whole subplot was added around Belle's mother and how she died. They tried to add a lot of emotion into the death of a character we had never known. Belle sings an entire song about it, and they halt the momentum of the film completely for this edition. It's melodramatic and unnecessary. I didn't need an explanation to accept that Belle's mother was dead. Most Disney princesses have one or no living parents. It was a useless addition. It had no purpose. Other things that Beauty and the Beast added include giving a reason for why all the staff were cursed with the Beast. This is, again, one of the favorites from those nitpickers I mentioned. The way the movie addresses this goes as follows. When Adam was a boy, he lost his mother, and his father was cruel to him. The staff were there and didn't intervene, so they must be corrupt as well. So let me get this straight. You're working in a castle with a cruel master who's corrupting and possibly abusing his son. Given the time period we're in, speaking up against that would either mean your death, or the loss of your livelihood, leading most likely to your death. Yep, sounds like they were all horrible people for wanting to not die. They definitely deserve the curse laid upon them. And really, did we need all that? I always assumed that the staff were cursed because they were there when the curse happened, and this ensured their silence. I don't care which reason is true. Because the point is that there was no point. Including that background was frankly confusing and convoluted. If you really wanted to explain why the staff were cursed, there were simpler ways to do that. Before I move past Beauty and the Beast, one other quick thing. They decided to add the fact that Gaston has just gotten back from a war and most likely has PTSD. Again, did we need all that? Don't try to humanize Gaston, Disney. I'm all for complex villains with nuance and intrigue, but Gaston ain't that. Trying to humanize him was a risk and not one that paid off. You should have just let sleeping dogs lie on that one. I think Disney has absorbed the concept of the circle of life to a dangerous degree. Believe it or not, Disney, but things that happen aren't always directly connected to each other. When it comes to shoehorning explanations that didn't need to be there, look no further than 2016's The Jungle Book. This movie was actually Disney's third attempt at a live-action Jungle Book movie. And honestly, I don't have very strong opinions about any of them. But the latest version did something interesting. It attempted to tie the plot into such a neat little bow that it became a knotted mess you can never undo. Shere Khan, voiced by Idris Elba, which was a fantastic choice by the by, is a de facto tyrant returning to the jungle. He discovers that Mowgli is living with the wolves, and because man is dangerous, Shere Khan wants to kill Mowgli. Simple enough, right? Now, the 1967 animated version reveals throughout the film that Shere Khan fears fire, which is why he hates man. The remake takes this a step farther. Shere Khan in this film has a bad eye and a scar from getting fire thrown in his face during a fight with a man. But then we learn that through some contrived circumstance, the man that attacked Shere Khan was Mowgli's father, and he was protecting Mowgli from the tiger, and that's why Shere Khan put the hit out on Mowgli. This reasoning behind Shere Khan's motivations falls apart pretty quickly once you start to pick at it. What if Mowgli hadn't been there when the tiger was injured, and he was just another man cub found abandoned in the jungle? Would Shere Khan be like, "Oh, you're fine. As long as you aren't the son of the man I vowed to hate for all eternity." No. This connection is meaningless. Shere Khan was burned by man, and Mowgli is a man cub. The two don't need to be directly related for the plot to work. I never wanted to know who the specific man was that Shere Khan encountered. Side note, all the animals in Jungle Book are fairly accurate, normal-sized creatures. Except for the giant snake and orangutan! I spent a lot of those scenes being just terrified of their sheer size. Until Christopher Walken started singing, then I was creeped out for a whole nother reason.
Oh, what we do? I wanna be like you. I wanna walk like you, talk like you too. You'll see it's true. Someone like me can learn to be like someone like you.
I'm gonna pause here and tell you five things I really liked in these movies. Number one, I mentioned this before, but some of these remakes had racist roots. The remakes allowed Disney to fix these issues. The 2019 Dumbo completely changed its story to write out its racism. The original film was racist enough to warrant a safety message before watching it on Disney Plus. 1955's Lady and the Tramp also earned this warning. When I learned they were remaking this, I was flabbergasted. Not only does this film have some of the most apparent racist elements in all of Disneydom, but those elements are tied inextricably to the plot of the movie. Let me explain. Aunt Sarah babysits and brings her two Siamese cats. They sing a racist song while destroying the house. Lady gets blamed for it, which leads to her getting muzzled, which leads to her running away to the street. The plot point of the cats cannot be easily written out. Instead, the filmmakers chose to keep the two cats, but with a very different feel and song. It also helped that the new song was written by POC songwriters. Number two, The Lion King now featured a voice cast of almost entirely POC actors, which was good. Also, they got James Earl Jones to be Mufasa again, and frankly, I would not have accepted anyone else in the role. Number three. Will Smith was refreshingly delightful as the genie. As someone who deeply loved Robin Williams' genie, I thought Smith did a great job of capturing the essence while making the character his own.
There is a lot of gray area in Make Me a Prince. I could just make you a prince.
Oh, no.
Right, you'll be snuggled up with that dude for the rest of your life.
Y'all see my palace?
Be specific with your words. The deal is in the details.
Number 4. I genuinely love Maleficent. The imagery is beautiful. The idea of doing a character study on a Disney villain is genius. Angelina Jolie was a lot better than I was expecting. She truly took her time to really dig into the character. Number 5. The Jungle Book expanded on Mowgli as a character, which I thought was great. There is a clear difference between a man cub's abilities and a wolf cub's. In the remake, Mowgli makes up for this by using his ingenuity. He made tools. I think this is a magnificent addition. As I'm sure many of you have noticed, Disney has been buying up studios like a teenager alone in the mall with their parents' credit card. Pixar, Marvel, Lucasfilm, and 21st Century Fox have fallen into Disney's clutches all in the last 15 years. There have been concerns that Disney is attempting to form a monopoly with these acquisitions. And while they are nowhere near an actual monopoly, Disney's chokehold on the film industry is already having negative effects. As of March 2020, Disney owned over 40% of all theatrical box office releases. Now, one of the main reasons monopolies are bad is simple. Less companies means less competition. Less competition means less product available, and generally, less good product available. Why would Disney make more movies if they are just competing against themselves? Add this to Disney corporate's push towards recreation of existing property, both in the Disney remakes and in the most recent Star Wars movies. What you end up with is a world where less and less original films get made. Bob Iger, now executive chairman of the Walt Disney Company, was CEO of Disney from 2005 to February 2020. Iger was nominated by Michael Eisner, who, as you know, orchestrated the Disney Renaissance. Both CEOs had very clear goals, the main one being Let's circle back to that less competition thing I mentioned. Disney's effect isn't just in controlling what they produce, but also how they can smother their competitors. The clearest way to see this is with the Academy Awards. Out of the 20 years that the Oscar for Best Animated Film has existed, Disney has won all but 6. To say Disney is an animation giant would be a massive understatement. It has gotten so big, it is jeopardizing the chances of other studios. We don't know what amazing projects were never made because of this. We need to talk about Mulan. Mulan is the most recent of the live-action remakes, premiering in September 2020. I consider this to be the most egregious of the Disney remakes. When Disney initially revealed its plans for live-action Mulan, there was pushback from several sides. By this time, I was already fearful that this decision could ruin yet another movie close to my heart. Disney's PR department went to work, stating that it wouldn't be a musical. Their intent was going to be honoring Chinese culture and the ballad that is so beloved by that culture. So it was a colossal mess. The film starts out very abruptly, with no proper introduction of the characters or really the world itself. After a small narrator intro, we move straight into the plot. If I had not seen the 98 version, I would have no idea who anybody was supposed to be. As it is, I still cannot tell you the names of most of the characters. That shows you just how incoherent the early parts of this film were. Greater than that is that the goal of honoring Chinese culture was completely missed. To contrast, Moana's creative team formed a board of experts from various Polynesian islands to dig heavily into the material at every step in the filmmaking process. They did so in an attempt to be sensitive to the cultures they were portraying. It wasn't perfect, but it was a strong effort. Mulan made no such effort. The director and all the screenwriters were white, and it shows. Siren J. Zhao does a great breakdown of all the cultural missteps in Mulan. The link to that is in the description. What confuses me most about the remakes in general is that, for several of them, a remake already exists. The Disney Broadway shows started way back in 1993 with Beauty and the Beast. There were still tours of this one as recently as 2016. The Lion King, which is very clearly the most popular of the Disney Broadway shows, has consistently sold out houses for over 20 years. I will admit I'm biased here, but the Broadway versions make a lot of the good changes found in the remakes with less of the bad ones. For example, Beauty and the Beast doesn't try to make Gaston sympathetic. Instead, they double down on his vanity and maliciousness. He even gets an additional song about his plot to incarcerate Maurice. Am I saying Disney should just be filming and releasing Broadway performances? Yes, yes I am. Come on, Disney, give me my Broadway. Despite the obvious weaknesses in these films, they pose an interesting question. Why do these movies do so well? Because they do. They've been extremely profitable for Disney. I believe nostalgia plays a very big factor in the success of these movies. Nostalgia is a feeling almost everyone is familiar with, categorized by a longing for the past. It's widely accepted by psychologists that nostalgia helps against depression or loneliness. Nostalgia is basically a mind's natural reaction to those feelings. This is because nostalgia isn't actually about the memories you recall, it's about the emotions attached to those memories. As Alan R. Hirsch published in a 1992 article, nostalgia is a screen memory, not a true recreation of the past, but rather a combination of many different memories, and in the process, all negative emotions get filtered out. It's, in essence, an idealized version of our happiest memories. At least in the USA, our world can often be isolating. The internet plays an interesting and central role in our lives now. It's invented some creative ways to keep us more connected to our friends and loved ones. I know 2020 would have been entirely different without the invention of video chatting platforms. However, the internet can often be an alienating place. Social media exemplifies this paradox, functioning both as a way to connect us, but also as a way to make us feel alone. Scrolling through feeds, seeing what others are doing, can often make a person feel like they are behind in life. Posting a status that doesn't get many likes can make someone feel that they're not being noticed. In preparing and filming this video, I've often felt like I'm shouting into the void, my voice lost on the sea of information on the internet. So thanks for watching, peeps. Studies suggest that the amount we rely on nostalgia changes with age. Although it can be useful our entire lives, younger adults tend to experience it more often. There are several theories as to why. When you become an adult, most people leave the relative safety of a childhood home. They enter a chaotic world with immensely more responsibilities. The stress of this can often trigger nostalgia, as can times when the world around you becomes more chaotic and unsure. Chaos? In our world? It's really no surprise that a lot of us are dealing with an increased need for nostalgia. And that need has become a driving force of not just the Disney remakes, but reboot culture across the television and film industry. However, almost all of the films Disney has chosen to remake have one thing in common. They were pushing boundaries. Films like Dumbo were early enough that the feat of even creating a full-length animation was new and risky. The Disney Renaissance wasn't known for sticking to the status quo. It pushed new ideas, adapted new stories that hadn't been done before. It added modern-day references into its films. It was a mixed bag, to be sure. But the whole was more than the sum of its parts. The Disney Renaissance changed the film industry forever. And yet, the remakes push on. Cruella is set to release in May 2021. It seems like they are trying to get back to the time of Maleficent by doing a villain-centric movie. It's starring Emma Stone and... I'm already tired. What will be the lasting effects of these remakes? Will today's children look as fondly on these films as we did the originals? I know that rewatching the 1996 version of 101 Dalmatians fills me with a nostalgic sense of peace. I don't know if future generations will feel the same about these remakes. What I do know is that some of the most influential filmmaking comes from taking risks. Catering to nostalgia is clinging to the past. Maybe it's time to let go of the past and instead focus on creating a more intriguing future for film. If you enjoyed this video and you want to see me make more of them, please do the like and subscribe thing. Thanks!